is this Jesus that we hear so much about? Who is He really? Sin cannot be in the presence of God. You see, God loves us, and He wants to be close to us. Do we truly comprehend what that means? Hello, friends. It's very good to be with you. This opportunity to get into the Word of God, and especially with this study here that we have at this time, we're going to be seeing fulfillment, yes, indeed, fulfillment of prophecy. So I'm very excited to be with you. We're going to get into this study, and there's a lot I want to share with you. We're living in an exciting time as we're getting nearer and nearer the coming of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And so before we get started into this topic, let's have a word of prayer. It's very important that our thoughts be guided by the Holy Spirit as we look at this. So I invite you to kneel with me. Let's have a season of prayer together and get right into this study. Our Father in heaven, we thank you so very, very much for this opportunity to come together and to study out of your holy word. We pray, Father, for the Holy Spirit to be very present with each one of us. Be with those who are hearing my voice, those who are watching these programs. Touch their hearts with the truth. Give me the words to speak, Lord, about this important subject and prophecy here, this present truth we have. And so, Lord, I pray that you will guide my thoughts. Give me the words to speak. And, Lord, we thank you for Jesus who made this all possible. And we pray this in His blessed name, for He's so worthy. Amen. Well, beloved, a few weeks ago on September 11th, I finally had the opportunity to read the new papal encyclical, and I've been moved to speak on this subject as it is a matter of fulfilling prophecy. I know that prophets of old would trade places with us in a heartbeat if it were possible, and we need to have that in mind. We are living in a time that others dreamed of living in. We have an opportunity that they did not have, and that is to see the finishing of this great controversy between Christ and Satan in our lifetime, friends. Now, on September 11th, it marked the anniversary of the terrorist attacks on the World Trade Center, on the Pentagon, and the plane there that crashed in Pennsylvania in that field back in the year 2001. And we all know, as Americans, that there approximately 3,000 people lost their lives in these attacks. And only the Lord knows the spiritual condition of each person. I think it's safe to say that some, if not many, were not prepared to face the judgment bar of God when they died that day. Such things, friends, are a reminder that there are spiritual forces at work to destroy the souls of men while they are yet in their sins. And I have to ask you, as we start this study, I have to ask you, what is your spiritual condition right now? Are you ready to meet the Lord in the judgment? Or will you echo these words that we find in Jeremiah chapter 8? And verse 20, the harvest is past, the summer is ended, and we are not saved. I hope, beloved, that you are not in that condition. Now the signs of the times, they tell us the harvest is fast coming to a close. Don't you see them? Can you see the signs? You know, Jesus told us to keep watch and to pray. Are you obeying Him? Now, Jesus gave us many things to look for, such as what is enumerated in Matthew chapter 24, Luke chapter 21. We see many of these things that He talked about being played out right now before our very eyes. But one of the greatest signs that we are in the day of our Lord's return is in seeing the healing of the deadly wound of the first beast depicted in Revelation chapter 13. And from our previous studies into prophecy, we know that this beast, this first beast, we know is a symbol of papal Rome, the Church of Rome. Yes, friends, the Catholic Church. Now, as I've said before, we are talking about a religious system. We're not separating out individuals or people per se. We're talking about a religious system that's a combination of church and state, as Rome is. Now, this first beast, according to God's word, received a deadly wound, if you will recall. But let's look at it in Revelation chapter 13, beginning with verse 1. And I stood upon the sand of the sea. Now, of course, we know that this is the Apostle John there on the Isle of Patmos. And he sees these things. He in vision, he says, I stood upon the sand of the sea, and I saw a beast rise up out of the sea, having seven heads and ten horns, and upon his horns ten crowns, and upon his heads, very interesting here that we need to take note of, the name of blasphemy. And the beast which I saw was like unto a leopard, and his feet were as the feet of a bear, and his mouth as the mouth of a lion. And the dragon gave him his power and his seat and great authority. Of course, we know the dragon is a symbol of Satan, the devil. But we see that John's talking about an amalgamation here of animals. And he says, and I saw one of his heads as it were wounded to death, and his deadly wound was healed, and all the world wondered after the beast. Well, you know, friends, I think it very appropriate for God to depict this power as possessing the mouth of a lion, which was the symbol of Babylon, remember? We studied Babylon about Babylon in Daniel, the books of Daniel, and the chapters of Daniel, and Daniel 2, and here in Daniel 7 is a symbol here. For this beast would speak, this beast of Revelation 13, this first one, would speak the words of Babylon, meaning confusion. Babylon, if you recall, was an idolatrous and blasphemous entity, as is the papacy. Babylon enforced worshiping an image by issuing a death decree designed to quell all dissent. And as you may recall, this decree was issued as the leaders of the nation were compelled to assemble there on the plain of Dura to perform an act of worship before this great image that was set up there by King Nebuchadnezzar, the king of Babylon. Now, we're familiar with this story of the three Hebrews. Most children are, of the three Hebrews in the fiery furnace. Now, the first beast of Revelation 13 also uses a death decree in order to quell any and all dissent to its idolatrous and blasphemous teachings. Now, the Dark Ages gives millions of testimonies to this truth. And we'll see in a moment that the Bible says that this persecution by the papacy will be repeated. Now, the Apostle John says that it was one of the heads of this leopard beast that was wounded to death. In other words, this wound fell upon the form of government that existed in the Roman Empire after its change from paganism, you know, the Caesars and such, to Christianity with the popes. Thus, it is evident that it was the papal head that was wounded to death and whose deadly wound was healed that John is telling us about. This wounding is also the same as the going into captivity that we see there in Revelation 13 and verse 10. Now, what about this wound? What's he talking about with this wound? Well, the wound was inflicted, you see, when the Pope was taken prisoner by Berthier, the French general under Napoleon. He did this in 1798 AD. and the papal government was for a time abolished. That was the wound. It was abolished. It was stripped of their power, both civil and ecclesiastical. And the Pope, Pius VI, was taken captive. And by the way, he died in exile at Valence in France, August 29, 1799. A deadly wound to the papacy. People at that time thought the Catholic religion was done away with forever. A deadly wound, you see. But a mere 197 days passed after the death of Pius VI before the initial evidence of the healing of this wound could be detected. Despite the prohibition of the French government preventing the election of a successor to Pius VI, a new pope, Pius VII, was elected on March 14th in the year 1800. Then the papacy, what did the papacy do? The papacy put her aims on America. And in the 1800s, began to infiltrate the education and the publishing institutions, as well as the legislative and judicial branches of the government of the United States. They did this all behind the scenes, friends. Step by step, you see, the wound has continued to heal. In 1929, two things happened. First, the stock market crash, of which the papacy was secretly instrumental, friends. But the stock market crash, it drove the country into a Great Depression. And Cardinal Gasparri and Benito Mussolini signed an agreement. And that agreement restored the temporal power of the papacy. She regained her treasure and lands. In the 1930s, the papacy secretly helped raise Adolf Hitler to power. Now, I could get into a lot of historical evidence to that and to why they were doing that, but that's not my point at this time. They secretly helped raise Adolf Hitler to power, though, as well as influenced the U.S. leadership to begin a welfare state, giving more power, you see, to the government over the lives of its citizenry. Why, Pastor Joel? Well, we'll see that prophecy is being fulfilled here. We'll see why here in just a few moments. Prophecy declares that the character, you see, of Romanism is to be replicated. And this was a very good start here. Through the rising power of a healing papacy, John Fitzgerald Kennedy, the first Catholic, was elected president of the United States. Vatican II was issued as a plan to bring all the protesting daughter churches back to the mother church. The Pope began making visits to the United States at this time. Later on, President Ronald Reagan recognized the Vatican as a state, as a country, by assigning an ambassador to represent the United States. And friends, presidents have continued to meet with the Pope on a regular schedule, even to this day. You see, friends, the wound continues to heal as Papal Rome gets closer to the world prominence and power it once had over the nations of the earth. Today, we can hear the roar of the beast as it calls for a new world order under one authority, and that authority is Papal Rome authority. Now, during the early healing process of the beast's wound in the mid-1800s, the Lord sent messages to His people by way of three angels. These messages are found in Revelation chapter 14, specifically verses 6 to 12, and we'll get to them in more detail a little bit later. The Bible prophecy students are very familiar with these messages, as they are actually present truth to God's faithful people today. But I want to draw your attention to the third of these angels' messages. In particular, Revelation 14, verses 9 to 12. Speaking of the third angel, and that's a message, see? This message. And the third angel followed them, that's the first two angels, saying with a loud voice, so all can hear, if any man worship the beast and his image and receive his mark in his forehead or in his hand, the same shall drink of the wine of the wrath of God, which is poured out without mixture, without mercy, you see, into the cup of his indignation. And he shall be tormented with fire and brimstone in the presence of the holy angels and in the presence of the Lamb, that Lamb being Jesus Christ. And the smoke of their torment ascendeth up forever and ever, and they have no rest day nor night, who worship the beast, this is speaking of the first beast of Revelation 13, who worship the beast and his image, we'll get to in a moment, and whosoever receiveth the mark of his name. Then we see a direct opposite here. We're talking about the beast and his followers, and verse 12 says, here is the patience of the saints. What about the saints? John says the saints are the ones that keep the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus. Now, we see here that this beast, this first beast of Revelation 13 that's being spoken of here also in Revelation 14, that this beast has a mark. And anyone who receives this mark will partake of the plagues, which are poured out without any mercy. Now, what is the mark of the beast? You know, when we talk about prophecy, that's the first thing everybody wants to know. And we've laid out the foundations, see, line upon line, precept upon precept, leading up to the describing of this mark of the beast. But everybody wants to know what it is. What is the mark of the beast? What is the mark of papal Rome's supposed authority over mankind? And by the way, when you think about this, God does not need an outward mark to determine who His people really are. He searches the heart, doesn't He? But what about the beast? Well, yes, the beast does need an outward mark to know who belongs to him, because he cannot read your heart. What does this mark represent anyway? It represents authority, doesn't it? So to receive this mark will show who has authority over your life. Isn't that right? Does God have a mark of authority? Yes, indeed He does. Well, what is God's mark or seal of authority? Well, let's take a moment and find out what the Bible says. Let's look at Genesis chapter 2. Clear back there in the very beginning, God made it very plain. Thus the heavens and the earth were finished, and all the host of them. And on the seventh day, God ended His work which He had made, and He rested on the seventh day from all His work which He had made. And notice what He did. He didn't just rest. Notice what God did. It says, and God blessed the seventh day. And not only did He bless that day, what else did He do? He sanctified it. Because that in it He had rested from all His work which God created and made. And friends, we see right here that God sanctified the seventh day as He set it apart as holy. He set it apart as a sacred day. This is the sign, you see. This day, it's a sign that He is the Creator of the heavens and the earth. And notice that He gives this again. He gives us again when writing His commandments into those tables of stone there at Mount Sinai. In Exodus 20, verses 8 to 11, talk to us about the fourth commandment. Why would God include this in the commandment if there was no sacredness to it? Because it is the sign that He is the sanctifier. He is the Creator God. It is His mark of authority. Exodus 20, verses 8 to 11. Remember the people had forgotten about God's law. They'd forgotten about His mark of authority. And He begins with this word, remember. Remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. And by the way, God wouldn't ask us to keep something holy if it was impossible for us to do. Remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. 6 days shalt thou labor and do all thy work, but the seventh day is the Sabbath of the Lord thy God. In it thou shalt not do any work, thou, nor thy son, nor thy daughter, thy manservant, nor thy maidservant, nor thy cattle, nor thy stranger that is within thy gates. For in 6 days the Lord made heaven and earth, the sea, and all that in them is, and rested the seventh day. Wherefore the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and hallowed it. It sounds a lot like Genesis chapter 2, doesn't it? God makes it even clearer to us, as we find in Ezekiel chapter 20, specifically verse 12. Look at these words. The Lord says, moreover, also, I gave them my Sabbaths to be a sign between me and them, that they might know what? That I am the Lord that sanctifies them. I'm the one who makes them holy. I'm the only one that can do it. Look at verses 19 and 20 of the same chapter in Ezekiel. I am the Lord your God. Walk in my statutes and keep my judgments and do them. And hallow my Sabbaths, and they shall be a sign, again, between me and you, that ye may know that I am the Lord your God, that I am the one who has the ultimate authority. This is my mark of authority. There is no mistaking, friends, that the seventh day Sabbath is the sign or seal of the Creator God. To those who are honest and study with a teachable spirit, it's obvious. It is His mark of authority. Now some say, well, Pastor Joel, that's the Old Testament. And the law was done away with at the cross. Well, notice what Jesus said in Mark 2, verses 27 to 28. Jesus said, the Sabbath was made for man, and not man for the Sabbath. Notice He didn't say the Sabbath was made for the Jew. He said the Sabbath was made for man. That's humanity. And not humanity for the Sabbath. Therefore the Son of Man is Lord also of the Sabbath. And again, in Matthew 12 and verse 8, Jesus said, for the Son of Man is Lord even of the Sabbath day. Oh, but yeah, that was done away with. Well, Jesus said something very interesting, friends, about the law in Matthew 5, verses 17 and 18. Notice what He says. He says, think not that I am come to destroy the law or the prophets. That means the law of God, the Ten Commandments, or the rest of inspired writings. I haven't come to do that. He says, I am not come to destroy, but to fulfill. That means I've come to live up to them, to show you that you can as well. For verily I say unto you, till heaven and earth pass, one jot or one tittle shall in no wise pass from the law, till all be fulfilled. My friends, I used to have an evangelist that I learned a lot from. He would say, stomp his foot and say, the earth's still here. He'd look up and see the sun and the clouds. Heaven's still here. The law of God is still binding. What is it really that Jesus is saying to us here in Mark and Matthew? He's saying that God did not create man because He had a Sabbath and needed someone to keep it. Rather, He knew that man needed opportunity for moral and spiritual growth, for character development. He needed time in which His own interests and pursuits should be subordinated to the study of the character and will of God, as revealed in nature, as revealed later in His Word, the Holy Bible. and all the inspired writings. And the seventh-day Sabbath was ordained of God to meet this very need. So to tamper in any way with the Creator's specifications as to when and how the day should be observed is tantamount to denying that God knows what is best for His creatures. God ordained that the Sabbath should be a blessing and not a burden. And it is to man's interest and not his injury to observe it, friends. It was designed to increase our happiness, not to work a hardship on us like the rabbis had done in Israel when Jesus came. They often thought He was breaking the Sabbath when He was saying that, no, I'm breaking the burdens that you have laid upon it. Now, knowing that the seventh day is the Sabbath and that the Sabbath is the mark of God's authority, we can begin our look at the beast's mark, for it will be a counterfeit, you see, to God's mark. If God's sign or mark is the seventh day, what was the beast? What has the beast declared its mark of authority to be? Well, I want to share with you some quotes from their very own lips, friends. This first one comes from a priest, Thomas Enright. And Thomas Enright says this, "The Bible says, remember that thou keep holy the Sabbath day. The Catholic Church says, no. By my divine power, I abolish the Sabbath day and command you to keep the first day of the week." And he says, "And lo, the entire civilized world bows down in reverent obedience to the command of the Holy Catholic Church." Well, that's not the only thing, friends. Cardinal Gibbons says this in the Catholic Mirror, "The Catholic Church, by virtue of her divine mission, changed the day from Saturday to Sunday." Friends, haven't you ever wondered where Sunday worship began? Here you see, has its origins in the Catholic Church. Monsignor Louis Segur, he says this, "The observance of Sunday by Protestants is an homage they pay, in spite of themselves, to the authority of the Catholic Church." And here's a gentleman by the name of Albert Smith. He was Chancellor of the Archdiocese of Baltimore. He says, "If Protestants would follow the Bible, they would worship God on the Sabbath day." He's talking about the seventh day. "In keeping the Sunday, they are following a law of the Catholic Church." And here is H.F. Thomas, Chancellor of Cardinal Gibbons. He says, "Of course the Catholic Church claims that the change, that is the change from the seventh day Sabbath to Sunday." He's talking specifically about that. He says, "Of course, the Catholic Church claims that the change was her act, and the act is a mark." You see this? It is a mark of her ecclesiastical authority in religious things. And then the Catholic Record of London, we can read this. "Sunday is our mark." There it is again. "Sunday is our mark of authority. The Church is above the Bible, and this transference of Sabbath observance is proof of that fact." Well, friends, I guess it depends on who you want to believe, doesn't it? The Bible says that the Sabbath, the seventh day of the week, known today as Saturday, is the Creator's sign or mark of authority. The beast power also makes it quite clear that the first day of the week, known today as Sunday, is its sign or mark of authority. Now the third angel of Revelation 14 said that anyone who receives the mark of the beast would forfeit eternal life and receive of the plagues. You remember? How will one receive the mark? How will it be done? Well, Revelation chapter 13 verses 11 to 17 gives us our answer. Can we discern it? We pray that the Lord gives us the Spirit to discern. Revelation 13 and verse 11. "And I beheld another beast coming up out of the earth, and he had two horns like a lamb, and he spake as a dragon. And he exerciseth all the power of the first beast before him, and causeth the earth and them which dwell therein to worship the first beast, whose deadly wound was healed. And he doeth great wonders, so that he maketh fire come down from heaven on the earth in the sight of men, and deceiveth them that dwell on the earth by the means of those miracles which he had power to do in the sight of the beast, saying to them that dwell on the earth that they should make an image to the beast which had the wound by a sword and did live. So here in Revelation 13 we see two beasts. We've identified these beasts before, but let's stop for a moment and see who the second beast represents again. This second beast that comes up out of the earth must arise sometime after the wounding or the captivity of the papacy. So it must be coming to power sometime around the year 1798 AD. It can't be somewhere, you know, way far in the future. You know, the Bible and God doesn't give us these nebuluses that are we have to guess at. He's very specific. He gives us all these indications and tells us specifically so that we will not be confused or deceived, you see. So it's got to come up around the year 1798 sometime. This second beast came up out of the earth, indicating that while the former kingdom arose in land populated with peoples and multitudes, this latter kingdom or government or political power was to rise in a new territory, not formerly occupied, you know, a new world, so to speak. This second beast has no crown, which would indicate that it would not have a kingly ruler. The second beast would exercise its power before or in the presence of the papal beast. So it is not a Catholic kingdom or government or political power, nor counted as part of the papal confederacy. It would be Protestant. The second beast's principles were to be lamb-like or Christ-like. And Christ advocated, friends, two great principles. First, separation of church and state. And second, religious liberty. Now, when we think of all these things, history testifies that from the start, the United States of America was characterized by its unique separation of what? Church and state. And allowing freedom of religion to all people. A land of religious liberty. The United States of America sprung forth with a gentleness and innocence based on republicanism and Protestantism. It is the United States that fulfills all the identifying marks of the second beast of Revelation 13. And we know this. We've studied this. The United States of America, which was founded by men who held liberty as a sacred honor, will not learn from history, though. The history of the first beast of papal Rome, specifically. And so they're doomed to repeat it by going against its founding principles, making an image of it, or combining the church and the state. They will enforce religious dogmas upon the people that go against the very laws of God. This country will eventually, friends, enforce worship just as papal Rome has before. Let's go back to Revelation 13. Let's look at verse 15. Revelation 13, verse 15. And he had power to give life unto the image of the beast, that the image of the beast should both speak and cause. That means legislate and enforce. So this beast, the image of the beast would both speak and cause, that as many as would not worship the image of the beast should be killed. And the image of the beast, state and church combined, they're going to enforce a religious dogma, the state is. They're going to legislate it and enforce it. Look at verses 16 and 17. And he causeth all, he's not prejudiced, all, both small and great, rich and poor, free and bond, to receive a mark, in their right hand or in their foreheads. And that, notice this, this is the emphasis here, that no man might buy or sell save he that had the mark or the name of the beast or the number of his name. The mark, name, or number is interesting to consider. And people have all kinds of ideas of what that might be. But we've got to let the Bible explain it, see, and history. But the mark, the name, or number, it seems to be laying out varying degrees here of association to the beast. You can receive the mark in the forehead or in the hand, which shows this varying association. Each association has to do with having the character, you see, of the beast in some way. And one thing is for sure, the Lord condemns any degree of association that gives you the character of the beast. Because if you have the character of the beast, thus his mark, you will receive of the plagues and be eternally lost. Ashes under the feet of the saints. And beloved, it really doesn't take much looking to see that the beast's wound is virtually healed and he is roaring. Can you hear it? Remember that it was Pope John Paul II in his encyclical letter, Dies Domini, meaning the day of the Lord, that stated this: Christians will naturally strive to ensure that civil legislation, remember what we read in Revelation? Right? He will legislate and enforce, see? And this is what the Pope Paul II said: Christians will naturally strive to ensure that civil legislation respects their duty to keep Sunday holy. You see, he was echoing the grand ultimate objective, really, of Vatican II, which is to use any means necessary to bring the entire world into worshiping on Sunday, marking them as members of the beast's church. Notice these remarks from Vatican II, from the documents of Vatican II, page 11. Moreover, any endeavor that seeks to make Sunday a genuine day of joy and rest from work should be encouraged. You read through, and that means legislatively and enforcing that legislation. Remember, Revelation 13 stated that no man might buy or sell save he that had the mark of the beast. How can you keep someone from buying or selling unless you have full control over the materials and the finances and the ability to enforce it? And as I read the new encyclical, which is an official letter from the Pope, that's what an encyclical is. But as I read this new encyclical by Benedict the 16th, entitled Caritas in Veritate, or Charity of Truth, I have to chuckle at that. It became urgent to share some of the highlights with you, friends. And I would encourage you to maybe you can get on the internet, you can Google it or whatever, and read it for yourself. A note of caution, though, you must be able to read between the lines because there are a lot of flowery words that are used to flatter the ears. And it may sound good, but it's really saying, it's not really saying what we may think he's saying. There's a hidden meaning. Now, the Pope has made many points in his letter, which seems to directly fulfill part of Bible prophecy, present truth for today. Here are some of the points to consider. First, the Pope is calling for a global government. A global government. Notice what he says. To manage the global economy, to revive economies hit by the crisis, to avoid any deterioration of the present crisis and the greater imbalances that would result, to bring about integral and timely disarmament, that's interesting, food security and peace, to guarantee the protection of the environment and to regulate migration, that's another interesting thing you could get into. There is urgent need, this is his own words, of a true world political authority. Here's a second thing from his encyclical. Church and state is to be united. That's papal Romanism. The Pope says this new political authority will make its decisions based on spiritual values. Get this, this is what he says. As a spiritual being, the human creature is defined through interpersonal relations. The more authentically he or she lives these relations, the more his or her own personal identity matures. It is not by isolation that man establishes his worth. Notice what he says. He says, but by placing himself in relation with others and with God. So you're going to have a global government. It's going to be church and state united, and they're going to decide that it's going to be based on spiritual values. He goes on. He says, the Christian religion and other religions can offer their contribution to development only if God has a place in the public realm, specifically in regard to its cultural, social, economic, and particularly its political dimensions. Like I said, church and state united. Here's a third point. Who's gonna rule this world government? The papacy is going to rule this new global government. These spiritual values cannot be derived from just any religion, friends. No, only the papacy, the mother church, see? Notice what he says, Pope Benedict XVI. He says, religious freedom does not mean religious indifferentism, nor does it imply that all religions are equal. Discernment is needed regarding the contribution of cultures and religions, especially on the part of those who wield political power. If the social community is to be built up in a spirit of respect for the common good, and we'll get to that in a moment too, the common good. He goes on, he says, such an authority would need to be regulated by law to observe consistently the principles of subsidiarity and solidarity, to seek to, notice this, to establish the common good. We see that again, don't we? Oh, we're going to do this for your good. You don't know what's best for your good. We will decide what's best for your good. He says, to establish the common good and to make a commitment to securing authentic, integral human development inspired by the values of what? Charity in truth. His own writing, his own encyclical. Then he says, they also require the construction of a social order that at last conforms, here it is, to moral order, to the interconnection between moral and social spheres. In other words, we are the only ones who can tell you what is moral. Here's a fourth thing that you read that he's laying out. Power to enforce the new government will be given to the papacy. Notice, in the face, this is the Pope writing this. In the face of the unrelenting growth of global interdependence, there is a strongly felt need, even in the midst of a global recession, for a reform of economic institutions and international finance so that the concept of the family of nations can acquire real teeth. Power to enforce their mark, see? Such an authority would need to be universally recognized. Isn't the Vatican universally recognized? And to be vested with the effective power to ensure security for all, regard for justice and respect for rights. Yeah. Obviously, he says, it would have to have the authority to ensure compliance with its decisions from all parties, and also with the coordinated measures adopted in various international forums. Remarkable, friends. This is Revelation 13 being fulfilled before our eyes. Here's a fifth thing. To have this power to enforce, they need to have control of the market, the buying and selling. The new world governing power will institute socialistic policies for government to redistribute wealth. Have you ever heard that term? Redistribute wealth. You take from the supposed wealthy and give to the poor, whether they've earned it or deserved it or not. That's having control, see? Notice what the Pope says. Economic life undoubtedly requires contracts in order to regulate relations of exchange between goods of equivalent value. But it also needs just laws and forms of redistribution governed by politics, which will be governed by the papal authority. See? He goes on. He says, globalization is a multifaceted and complex phenomenon which must be grasped in the diversity and unity of all its different dimensions, including the theological dimension. In this way, it will be possible to experience and to steer the globalization of humanity in relational terms, in terms of communion and the sharing of goods. Whew, remarkable. It's remarkable to see prophecy fulfilled before your eyes. The Pope's views on the redistribution of wealth and his agenda set forth in this encyclical, Charity in Truth, echo many of the same themes that Barack Hussein Obama, President of the United States, campaigned for last year. Notice this. Dan Gilgoff writes this, a U.S. News and World Report, July 10th, 2009. Quote, the encyclical ramped up the level of White House enthusiasm for this meeting because you can't read it without sensing that these two men, that's the Pope and the President of the United States, friends, that these two men are seeing economic questions the same way, says a Catholic advisor to the White House. Then Gilgoff says, the Holy Father's emphasis on putting the human person at the center of the economy strongly echoes themes that Obama campaigned on and is working to implement. You know, friends, that labor unions are to be empowered in this new world order to help control enforcement of the redistribution of wealth, stealing from the rich who've earned it, and giving to the poor who have not. You know, by the way, the Bible says, if you don't work, you don't eat. There's a principle there. Again, I'll read this. This is from the encyclical. The repeated calls issued within the church's social doctrine for the promotion of workers' associations, that's labor unions, friends, that can defend their rights must therefore be honored today even more than in the past as a prompt and far-sighted response to the urgent need for new forms of cooperation at the international level as well as the local level. The global context in which work takes place also demands that national labor unions, which tend to limit themselves to defending the interests of their registered members, should turn their attention to those outside their membership. And in particular, to workers in developing countries where social rights are often violated, as if they really care about a person's social rights. The protection of these workers, partly achieved through appropriate initiatives aimed at their countries of origin, will enable trade unions to demonstrate the authentic, ethical, and cultural motivations that made it possible for them in a different social and labor context to play a decisive role in development. You read between the lines, friends, and it's giving control to the labor unions to enforce the mark, the buying and selling. I mean, Mr. Obama took control of General Motors and Chrysler with the intent of handing them over to the trade unions. The unions will be the bulldog, you see, for intimidation and control of the new world authority. And we've witnessed just that in reaction to the citizens of the United States expressing their disapproval of for this national health care. Union thugs have come in to town hall meetings and intimidate those who were wanting to express their objections. And they were very successful at this intimidation. Now, of course, don't get me wrong, friends. Not Everyone in a trade union agrees with these tactics. But by belonging to the union, you are supporting and sustaining them in their thuggery. Unions are no longer, if they really ever were, a sanctified agency for the good of the workers. They were formed to have control over individuals, you see. One Bible writer, writing specifically about trade unions, says this: the trades unions will be one of the agencies that will bring upon this earth a time of trouble such has not been since the world began. A few men will combine to grasp all the means to be obtained in certain lines of business. Trade unions will be formed, and those who refuse to join these unions will be marked men. The time is fast coming when the controlling power of the labor unions will be very oppressive. Well, friends, we've seen it. Here's the same author says this: these unions are one of the signs of the last days. Men are binding up in bundles ready to be burned. They may be church members, but while they belong to these unions, they cannot possibly keep the commandments of God. For to belong to these unions means to disregard the entire Decalogue. That's the Ten Commandments. What a statement. These words were penned over 100 years ago, my friends. Prophecies being fulfilled. It's amazing. Getting back to the encyclical here of the Pope, Charity of Truth. There's a seventh point. Building the city of God. How remarkable. Notice this, what the Pope says. Man's earthly activity, when inspired and sustained by charity, contributes to the building of the universal city of God, which is the goal of the history of the human family. Wow. Remarkable. Control of the world from their own universal city. The ungodly that lived, if you recall, after the flood, built a city named Babel, and they tried to build a tower to heaven. And they would have succeeded if God had not intervened. The ungodly today are attempting the same feat, to control the world. The Bible tells us that God will again intervene before His church is completely destroyed by spiritual Babylon. And the Bible also tells us that Jesus is personally preparing the city of God in heaven. Remember, His kingdom is not of this world, He said to Pilate. I'm about to run out of time, friends, and there's so much to share with you. In his encyclical, the Pope is redefining religious liberty while claiming not to, as he says, to interfere in any way in the politics of states. The Pope redefines liberty as happening when the world obeys laws shaped by the Roman Church's spiritual values. And according to the Pope, as the Church influences states to enforce its view of truth on others, people are set free. He says, this mission of truth is something that the Church can never renounce. There's another terrifying thing to me when you look at it in line to the Bible truth, and it's spiritualism. Spiritualism, or the non-biblical belief that man has an immortal soul. It helps to ensure the Pope's global agenda as well. He states in this encyclical, man is God's creature whom God chose to endow with an immortal soul. This is an outright lie from hell, friends. The Lord says in Ezekiel 18:4, behold, all souls are mine, as the soul of the Father, so also the soul of the Son is mine. The soul that sinneth, it shall die. So the Bible emphatically denies that God endowed man with an immortal soul. But regardless of this, the vast majority of Christians believe this lie, and along with the error of Sunday sacredness, the people are prepared to receive the mark of the beast. Friends, we can see all the prophecy pieces coming together right before our very eyes. The state of the economy, we had the housing bubble, unemployment, financial collapses, etc. They've paved the way for government control as it takes over mortgages and banks, auto plants, etc. The supposed universal health care is a huge missing piece of this control, and it will be passed in some form unless God intervenes. This will enable the government to have control over virtually every aspect of a person's life. And this has to happen. It has to happen in order to enforce the mark of the beast, my friends. And it will happen sometime. The Bible has said so. Now, there's one thing I do want to make clear. The mark of the beast is not being enforced right now. So no one has this mark yet. It isn't until Sunday observance is enforced by law that you will receive the mark. Remember, it doesn't happen until the image of the beast or church and state is set up. Notice this from the book The Great Controversy, page 445. When the leading churches of the United States, uniting upon such points of doctrine as are held by them in common, shall influence the state to enforce their decrees and to sustain their institutions, then Protestant America will have formed an image of the Roman hierarchy, and the infliction of civil penalties upon dissenters will inevitably result. We are close to having that image set up, aren't we? And once the image is set up, it won't be long before the mark is enforced. But not before, beloved. Not before. There are good people in all the fallen churches who have to hear the three angels' messages and hear the voice of the Master and come out. They do not know the Sabbath truth yet, so they haven't received the mark. It's not time yet, but it is drawing so very, very close. Are you ready? I remember being at the Brookfield Zoo several years ago. And as we were at the far end of the zoo, a lion began to roar. And even though he was at the very opposite end of the zoo, it sounded like he was right next to us. The devil is going about as a roaring lion, and he wants you. He wants you to have his mark. Can you hear the roar of the beast, beloved? If you cannot, then I encourage you to go to God and to His Word prayerfully and study to show yourself approved. Soon Jesus will come and He'll want to know. He'll want to know if there is faith on the earth. By your words and deeds and character, will you be able to say yes? Jesus says to us, when these things begin to come to pass, then look up and lift up your heads, for your redemption draweth nigh. Friends, let's have the faith to look up. Let's have the faith to look up. If we are to have that faith then, we must have it now. If you want to have that faith, pray with me. Father in heaven, we thank you so much for this opportunity to see prophecy fulfilled before our eyes. And we shudder at seeing these things. So increase our faith, please, Lord. Give us the faith we need to stand, though others may fall. We humbly ask this in Jesus' name.